In the previous video, we've analyzed this little circuit here, that is a discrete curve tracer. Through a circuit simulator, we were able to understand in great detail what each component does. And if you didn't watch it, I recommend that you do so, otherwise it would be quite difficult to follow this video. The idea of this video is to improve this circuit, obviously still using only discretes and passives. Let's start by saying that this circuit works quite well. However, there are a couple things one can add to make it quite better. First of all, let's say what I did not improve, that is, the inverted x-axis. I mean, why fix it if it is not broken, right? You can still perfectly understand the characteristic even if it is mirrored. If you are that triggered about the inversion, well, just use a mirror. Getting back to the serious stuff, let's do a 30 seconds recap on how this circuit works, only for those who have already watched the previous video. This part here is an unstable multivibrator, and it generates a square wave that synchronizes everything that happens in the circuit. Here we have a simple RC filter, which makes a sort of triangular wave from the square one to sweep the collector voltage of the transistor under test. And last but not least, this part generates the step ramp signal that we need to step the different base currents. The first problem is the most obvious one. You may have noticed the very big resistor going into the base of the transistor under test. The high value is needed, otherwise we would discharge the capacitor generating the step ramp. Indeed, instead of the flat steps, we would see something like that, reflecting in a roll-off of the collector current in the characteristic. So what if we want a higher base current to evaluate things like the early effect? That's easy, we can simply implement another common collector stage, which has a very high input impedance and amplifies the input current by beta. If you are feeling wild, you can even add a trimmer to choose your desired input current. The second problem involves the collector. In the original circuit, the collector voltage was generated through this RC filter here. From the starting square wave signal that looks like this, we obtain something like that. Where's the problem? Well, the problem is evident if we look at the synchronization of that signal with respect to the step ramp. If we zoom in, you can see that the collector voltage changes while we change the base current value, so in the characteristic we'll see happening something like this. This is visible in the oscilloscope as well. Now, the solution to this problem is so simple that I don't know why it wasn't implemented in the original circuit. And here it is. We simply take the square wave signal from the other side of the multivibrator. In this way, the collector sweep will start just after the base current change, and it will finish the transient approximately in the middle, so we are sure that the collector voltage is zero before changing again the base current. So that change will happen in the zero point, and we won't see it in the oscilloscope signal. Now, what about the collector resistor? You may have noticed that I've modified that resistor from the original value to a very low one. Why? Well, if you look at the characteristic on the oscilloscope, you can notice how the lines get shorter for higher collector currents following a straight line. This line here is nothing but the load line given by the collector resistor. If we reduce its value, we can change the slope of that line and see more of the characteristic. However, there is a trade-off. Following this quite famous law, since we are measuring the collector current by measuring the voltage drop on that resistor, it is trivial how we'll have a much lower voltage, so more noise will be visible on the oscilloscope. So let's see if these two modifications help. And I'd say things look much better. And we could even stop here. However, at this point, you should know that I love overcomplicating things, and it seems that you like to watch. So I was quite triggered about this second branch here, and I wanted to understand where it came from. My first guess was the most obvious one. The capacitor was still getting discharged by the transistor under test, so I've tried literally everything to buffer that voltage there. However, nothing worked. So I discarded that first hypothesis. Then I started to think about the discharging circuit. What if the cause was the leakage current from that transistor there? And once again, I tried everything and I couldn't solve the problem. I even tried to bump up the capacitor value to 10 microfarads by also increasing the other one to maintain the same number of steps, and again, it didn't work. But just before giving up, I had the right idea. If we look once again at the simulations, you can see that even here the second line is visible. If we look at the collector voltage and collector current signals, you can see why. At the same collector voltage, red line here, you can see we have a different collector current value during the rise transient and the fall one, due to that very weird dip of the current. And after several distressing hours, turns out that the dip is given by that very annoying parasitic capacitance between the base and the collector. This can be proved by adding another capacitor at that junction, and it is visible how by increasing the capacitance value, the decrease of the collector current in the second line is more and more evident. To understand what's happening, let's plot again the collector voltage and current. This time we'll plot another signal as well, the red one, that is the derivative with respect to time of the collector voltage. Why is it important? Well, you should remember that the current flowing through a capacitor is given exactly by that derivative there. So we can plot in blue the current coming from the stepped ramp, in green the current entering the base of the transistor, and in light blue the one entering the capacitor, here representing the parasitic capacitance of the transistor. And you can see that when there is the change from the rise to the fall transient of the collector voltage, a negative current flows from the parasitic capacitor. Negative meaning it goes from the base to the collector. The current coming from the step ramp stays constant, thus the current entering the base is reduced, and so we'll experience a reduction of the collector current as well. And this fully explains what we see on the oscilloscope. Indeed, if we look at the original characteristic and the improved one, everything can be explained if compared with the collector signals. The original one had a quite fast fall transient, resulting in a big voltage variation and thus collector current reduction due to the parasitic capacitance stealing the base current. So the return line is much lower than the rise one. In the improved version, the full transient is smoother, reducing this effect. That's why the return line is much closer to the rise one. But it is also brighter since it is also slower. Now that we understood what was the problem, we need to find a way to solve it. At this point, there is a solution that I think you may have already guessed. We need to make the collector voltage smoother. Maybe a sine wave, yeah, that should do. This is absolutely the way to go with if you're building a curve tracer with op amps, thanks to which you can generate a very good sine wave easily. However, using only transistors, it is kind of complex. Yes, we do have already a square wave. With some heavy filtering, we could get a decent sine wave, but we'd reduce too much the peak voltage of the wave, and we need a high enough peak voltage to test a good portion of the transistor under test characteristic. Then are we stuck? Sort of. But if you think hard enough, there's a little trick we could try to implement. We could even call it cheating, but hey, if it works, it works, right? The idea is the following. We understood that the transition from the rise transient to the fall one is problematic due to the peak voltage variation. So why don't we just get rid of it? What I mean is, if we do the transition as fast as we can, the voltage derivative will still be huge. However, if it is fast enough, it won't be visible on the oscilloscope. Did you see that? I don't think so. The circuit I came up with is this one. You can see we only need two additional transistors. It is quite easy to understand. When the input square wave rises, the first transistor is on. Thus, the voltage on the base of the second transistor will be approximately zero, keeping it off. The capacitor can then be charged through its resistor. When the square wave goes to zero, the first transistor will turn off, and the second one will turn on through the two resistors. The capacitor will get discharged suddenly through the second transistor, giving rise to a very fast transient. This is the collector voltage we obtain, and if you compare it with the previous one, you can see how the fall transient drastically changed. Now, will it work? Well, I'd say we can be quite happy with the result. Now, no second lines are visible. Well, if you increase by a lot the intensity on your oscilloscope, you can just barely see those lines, since, as we said, we even made them worse actually. See how much the collector current decreases, but they are so fast that they are not visible. and a high intensity will burn the phosphor off your oscilloscope screen anyway. So, well, yeah, we basically swept the problem under the rug, but if it works, it works. Now, to be honest, I have no idea of how this will look like on a modern digital oscilloscope, and since my finances only allow me to have this terrible oscilloscope, probably even older than I am, I have no way to know. If the secondary lines are too visible, just get back to the middle version with the RC filter on the other side of the unstable multivibrator and you should be good to go. If any of you try to build this circuit, please let me know how it looks like for you.